We're here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from Al Jam, who asks, "Hey, Bellhop, my wife really likes Stratego and is wanting a new board game suggestion. If it helps, she also enjoys Forbidden Island and Choose Your Own Adventure Escape from the Haunted House."
Thanks for the question, Al. I think we can help you out with that.
So personally, I'm a bit of a Stratego fan. I used to play it with my dad when I was a kid. I'm pretty sure I played a bit with our neighbors as well. But I only played that until my dad got a copy of Electronic General, which honestly totally replaced Stratego for us. But I do at least have a lot of experience with the original game.
So what we decided to do tonight is to have each of the three of us recommend five games that we recommend for Stratego fans, giving Al and his wife a total of 15 games to choose from in the end.
Before that, though, I want to spend a minute talking about what we think people actually like about Stratego. And I think this is important whenever you're giving any game recommendations. So don't just be like, "Oh, Stratego, I know what Stratego is about." Find out why the person likes the game. Why are people into Stratego? And why is the game still around? Why are people still playing it? Why is it still on the bestseller list? What do people enjoy about Stratego, the game itself? Now, the first thing I think of when I think of Stratego is that fog of war, the fact you can't see the opponent's pieces until you actually get into a battle and then they're revealed. And then there's a memory element, because once you saw the troop, you now have to remember which troop that is because they turn back. So there is that part of it, but there's more to it. In addition to that, there's a very important part that people sometimes forget when they're talking about this game, is that the initial setup is also blind. You put up a screen and everyone rearranges their troops and places them where they want. And a big part of that is hiding your flag. So there's not just the memory and the blindness while you're fighting. There's also the setup at the beginning.
Yeah, I do expect that this was most people's introduction to the concept of a fog of war, though it's likely now computer games that have become that introduction instead. While it's a fun aspect, I do also suspect, however, that it is the memory aspect that turns a lot of people off of Stratego.
Now, the next thing is it's a war game, right? It's two sides facing off. It's two opposing armies that happen to be lined up across from each other on a grid. There's different troop types. Now, most are just basically numbers, right? 1 through 10 that set a pecking order, though every number does have an assigned actual unit type assigned to it. Some of those have special abilities. And there's a lot. There are a lot of troops on a board when you set up Stratego. Like, chess fans are going to look at this and go, "Oh my gosh, look at that." I actually got to say, it looks neat because it looks like two armies kind of lined up to face off against each other.
And interestingly, it's actually reduced. The original game had 40 pieces on each side, ooh, not 30. Now, the big thing a lot of people, any real Stratego fans and connoisseurs out there will have an opinion on is which way should the numbers go? There are actually two different versions of Stratego, where one, the highest is 1, and the other, the highest is 10. And there are still, I'm sure, forums filled with debates about which is the better solution.
Sure they are.
But again, it is a war game, right? Not only does it look like a war game, it is a war game. It is two armies battling against each other to capture the other flags. And while you can also say arguably chess and checkers are war games, this has in almost all its versions been directly a war game with physical representations in one form or another of military pieces in action.
Now, speaking of chess, I would say this is chess-like in a way. To me, this is a game that, like, people who play chess can easily pick up Stratego in a way, and people who play Stratego can move into chess pretty easily because you're moving one piece over at a time on a grid. Every piece has a set way it moves. Now, in this game, they all move the same, but there is a set way all the pieces move. And more importantly, the goal is capture that one specific piece of your opponent's. And then there's some of the things where different pieces are good at different things. Some are good at attacking. Some are good for defense. Some are good for bluffing. Others are set up specifically to counter the other pieces in a kind of rock, paper, scissors type of way.
Now, of course, one of the big differences that you'll run into, of course, is the setup. Whereas chess, everyone knows where the king is. Everyone knows where your opponent's king is. That's never going to change. How you get to it is the point. Whereas in Stratego, you never know where the flag is or where the bombs are, the sappers.
Now, another thing that I think is a big draw of Stratego that a lot of people I've talked to who enjoy the game really like, and what I loved the most as a kid, were the gotcha moments. Now, these come from the bombs, the miners, and the fact the spy, the lowest strength piece, can defeat the highest strength piece. If the spy attacks first, that is, not the other way around. And then there's also the ability of the scouts, which can move and attack on the same turn, where you're thinking you're far enough back and you're all good, and all of a sudden this piece moves and then attacks. You're like, wait a minute, I thought I was safe.
Yeah, and while I don't disagree, I definitely think that is a big draw. I also think it is, yet again, sort of another weakness of the game, as the number of piece types and the interactions with sappers and spies and bombs create a complexity which distracts a little bit from the sort of simple purity you get in a game like chess, where if a piece lands on another piece, it dies. It goes away, period. Yep. Or in checkers, if it jumps over, it's gone. You don't have to worry about, oh, well, I jumped over you, but what were you that I jumped over? It doesn't matter, and things like that. You know, all of a sudden there's artillery in chess. it's an interesting feature, but again, I think it can be both a draw and a drawback, depending on your opinion of that particular aspect.
And the one thing I do like is I think it pretty much is like right there in your face about that's what it is. So that is one thing most people, I think, sitting down to play Stratego know what they're getting into. They're not going to be surprised by this. Now, another one that I can think of is the fact that it's fairly simple, right? Like the overall mechanics is move a piece orthogonally or diagonally. And if it bumps into another piece, they fight, show them whoever has the higher number wins. We're going to go with the higher number version. Sorry, people who are lower number Stratego fans. That's the current rules for the company who currently owns the rights to it, which is Playmates, I think it was. It's not a kid's game, right? It's definitely no Candyland or Roll and Move, but it's pretty simple, right? It's maybe a step up from Monopoly, maybe on the same level because the trading mechanics in Monopoly might be difficult for kids. It's very accessible. Rules are on one page, like in most copies of Stratego over the years, it's been in the box top. That's how I learned the game, was the top of the box. And the hardest part is just learning what the special pieces do. But really, there's not a lot. There's the sappers or miners that can defeat bombs. There's the bombs that defeat everything. There's the flag. And then there's the funky mechanic with the spies and the scouts, which for someone brand new to board games might be a bit much. But for anyone who's an experienced gamer, that's pretty low on the complexity scale.
Yeah, the current rule set I saw was 2 pages of text, which had been padded out to 6 pages with all the graphics involved. Yeah. So it was they literally, if you take out all the graphics and extraneous stuff, it's 2 pages long, but it's a 6-page rule book in the box, apparently.
Fair enough. Examples are good.
That's true.
Yeah.
Lots of example text would be good.
So while there certainly is some depth to Stratego, I would argue, however, it's not anywhere near the level of complexity of, say, chess, and is really sort of a family weight game, as it relies mostly on observation and memory, as well, once you have figured out the better starting positions and layouts, as opposed to any sort of pure strategic play, which comes from that open information you get in games like chess, Sensu, and what have you.
Yeah, and I got to say that is one of the things that definitely does happen with this game is people who take the game very seriously, like chess people, players, chess masters, there are set starting formations and opening moves that people expect and things people have figured out. And I got to say, when I was doing our research for this episode, I found an awful lot of Stratego setup strategy when just looking to find games similar to it. Now, the other thing I do want to call out, we already said basically it's a war game, but it is Napoleonic. Now, I know there are a lot of Napoleonic war gamers out there, though I don't know how many are drawn to Stratego, but I bet you some people who started with Stratego then went on to other Napoleonics.
Yeah, it's interesting. Given the number of themes, rethemes, and versions of Stratego out there in the 120 years of its existence, at least if you account L'Attaque, the original patent, I suspect many, if not perhaps most people, have no idea that it was a Napoleonic war game.
Well, the current version is still the Napoleonic. The Playmates, the current Stratego classic you can go get at Walmart right now, features the Napoleonic units that were from the original, including the original artwork. I mean, it's now back to plastic pieces again with the etch. So it's still there. I don't know if people know that they're Napoleonic. I don't know if it's put it out on the front of the rule book anywhere. I didn't grab a copy of the rule book to check, but it's definitely going back to its roots with that version. But man, yes, there are a lot of varieties out there. And since Al didn't specify, I'm assuming we're going back to base Stratego here. So those are the things I thought made Stratego stick out. The one thing I didn't catch there that I'm thinking of now that we're talking about this is that bluffing aspect. There is a definite aspect of bluffing of the, oh, better watch out, this is my miner, or watch out, that could be a scout, or you make a huge move on the right front and it ends up it's all your weakest troops. So there is also another thing to think of, which I don't think it's going to affect the games on our list tonight, but there is definitely a bluffing aspect to Stratego.
Personally, for me, I've always sort of assumed it was the cool commercials that did more for this game than any intrinsic quality the game itself may have. And I don't say that to be harsh about the game. There are definitely some people who love this game, and it has a place in even modern gaming circles. But the physicality of the board and the pieces are a powerful selling point of this game. I mean, you could play this game with little paper standees on a sheet of paper in front of you, and it would just lose a lot of the appeal of having those, you know, crenellated pieces and the board and seeing the bridges and the lakes and what have you. And, you know, there's some physicality to that. And they always reinforced that in the commercials. I remember, at least in the 80s, I don't know what a modern commercial looks like for any, but I definitely remember some bombastic commercials for this product, which is just a fun board game.
All right. So looking at all the things we just mentioned, my first game recommendation, which actually has a lot of the things we just talked about, including the bluffing, is going to be Hammer of the Scots. So this is one of the Columbia Block War Games, Columbia being the publisher and Block War Games being a series of games they published. These are games that use wooden blocks with stickers on them. And the reason I mentioned this is it uses the same Fog of War system. The wooden blocks only have stickers on one side, and you can't see what your opponent has. Your blocks stand up, and you don't reveal them until you get into a fight, and then you put them face down, you resolve your combat, and then they stand back up. Now, another reason is the war theme, of course, so that's a good follow-up to Stratego, though I do have to warn people that this does not have that light, easy to learn aspect of Stratego. This is definitely a significant step up in weight and complexity, but compared to heavy war games and chit and counter games and Advanced Squad Leader, this is extremely light. Like, if you call this a war game in the wrong crowd, they're going to be like, no, that's a board game. That doesn't qualify as a war game. As far as hex-based war games go, this is on the lighter side of the scale. And please don't be intimidated by it. Like, I was scared of this game until Deanna and I played our first game, and I was like, this really isn't bad. Just make sure you learn what the term hex side means. I didn't know that one going in, and that made the rule book a little confusing.
Yeah, my first thought here was something very similar, Commands and Colors Ancients. And then I was thinking, because of the theme, maybe I should go with Commands and Colors Napoleonics. And I will admit, though, that as a next step from Stratego, Commands and Colors is a bit of a leap. So maybe for folks who don't have a ton of hobby game experience, Battle Lore might be a better first step if you like fantasy, or Memoir 44 if you want modern military. We're talking about hex-based war games that simulate both Fog of War and ever-changing battlefield conditions through card play. The battlefield is divided into three fronts, left, center, and right, and you play order cards that let you do things like move two units on your right front or move three light units anywhere. The big draw here is a super simple combat system, and it keeps these games much lighter than most hex-based war games, much like Mo was just talking about with Hammer and the Scots. It's not as intimidating as it looks.
All right, well, for my first recommendation, sadly, I went to the bad thing. I did the out of print. But there are still copies around to be found if you are interested. And I think if you really are interested in Stratego and Lord of the Rings, it's worth taking a look, because I am going to talk about Lord of the Rings, The Confrontation. It's a themed, smaller version of Stratego, but not just a retheme. This is actually designed by the great Renier Nitzia. So as opposed to just retheming the original game with some Lord of the Rings characters, there are two versions of the game that exist. Originally, it just came out as Lord of the Rings, The Confrontation. And then it came out again as Lord of the Rings, The Confrontation, sometimes known as a deluxe version and sometimes not. But it is an improved deluxe version with some updated figures and rules available. And that is the newest version going forward after they stopped printing the original. Improved components, additional characters, and gameplay. But again, we have a Renier Nitzia battle game that uses the same sort of Fog of War, but on a smaller board, and very much within the Lord of the Rings theme.
Yeah, that one honestly would have been my number one recommendation if I didn't find out it was badly out of print. I actually own this game. It is a fantastic game. It is a much, it's not simpler though. Okay, so you have a lot less units to worry about, but every unit has its own special abilities. So you've got things like the small hobbits can defeat the tough things, and Eowyn can, of course, kill the ring lord because how the book read, not the movies played. And it's got all that going from it. And the hobbits have an ability where if a Nazgul moves into their space, they can move one away. And like, so you get all that hidden movement and complex abilities, but Lord of the Rings, and then thematically Lord of the Rings too. It's not just numbers in that game. If I remember, you have one of each number, 1 to 10, and each represents a different character. One side's playing Sauron's side, the other's playing the Fellowship. Fantastic game if you can find a copy of it. Next up, I'm going to recommend War Chest from Alderic Entertainment Group, or AEG. This is another abstract war game that I think is just honestly not a big step up in complexity of Stratego. If you can remember what the different units do in that one, you can figure out the units you control in this one. Because this game features a wide variety of troop types, but it's asymmetric. Every player will have different units. And instead of the game being about capturing the opponent's flag, you're about holding objectives on the board. So no fog of war here, except it is a bag builder, so you never quite know what your opponent's going to pull out of the bag. But it is an awesome light war game, and it's got that bit of chess-like feel, right? It's got that abstractness. And as an added bonus, in case you like, you love Stratego but want to play with four, this one does play teams with four, so that may be a consideration for you as well, Al.
All right. Well, next up, I have the Duke, Lord's Legacy, which is the new current version of the Duke, which we have spoken about many, many times on this show. While it also doesn't have a fog of war, it does have that random element of bag pulls for your pieces. So there is that memory aspect of trying to figure out what you've pulled, what your opponent has pulled, and what may be remaining in the bag. Again, thankfully, all your piece moves are right there for everyone to see, except there's also a different set of moves on the other side of that piece. So each time a piece moves, it flips over and gets a different move set from what it had the last move. You know, again, it's you'll get a lot of those same sort of feelings of Stratego, but in a much more modern abstract strategy game.
Yeah, I love the Duke. I had put both the Duke and War Chest on my list, but since you guys stole them, I decided to go with King Me. Because it's strategic, but easy to learn, and I think that will appeal to Stratego lovers who are looking for just that tiny step more. It's very approachable. Everyone understands checkers, and King Me is like checkers for gamers. So,
all right, my next one is, I don't even know. It's like, is it a jump up, or is it like you're diving into a different pool? But something about looking at Stratego setup reminds me of my teen years when I got very addicted to a game in the 80s, and that is Warhammer Fantasy Battle, which I am putting on this list tonight because a brand new edition is out now under the name Warhammer The Old World. Yes, the square back bases are back, and the rank and file troops lined up on your side facing off against the opponents is there. Now, I picked this over Napoleonic miniature games because there are a ton of those out there, but most tend to be very complicated and very detailed and trying to be simulationist. I'm sure some Warhammer fans will hate me for saying this, but Warhammer is not a simulation game. It is a go out, have fun kind of game where you're just chucking the dice. Another thing is that Games Workshop stuff is really easy to get to and find. Most major cities have a Warhammer store and you can get it online. Opponents can be easy to find. Here in Windsor, we have multiple stores that host Warhammer events. Plus, Warhammer has the fun gotcha rules as far as I'm concerned. Just check out the rules for Orcs and Goblins to see some of those. Plus, there is some fog of war. It's both how you place units on the map, or, you know, I place a unit, you place a unit, I place a unit. But even more so, the fact you don't know what the opponent's bringing to the table. You have 3,000 points or 10,000 points to make your army, and you do that not in front of your opponent. You do that off the board and then show up and then be like, okay, so what are you playing? And like, I'm playing Lizard Man. You're like, oh God, does he have a Croxagore? You know, you don't know until you set it up. And if you want, do get into this and do enjoy it, you can always then move into the more historic rule set. And there is technically a fan-created Warhammer Napoleonics out there as well, but the only place I could find that was on the Internet Archive, so it seems like that has no longer supported.
I was thinking about the fog of war and the memory aspects of Stratego, And so I thought Wallenstein might be something that folks who like Stratego would dig. Like the parts of the game that I was thinking of is the hidden action selection and the way the combat's resolved via the cube tower. And with the hidden action selection, you can get that bluffing ha-ha moment, right? And then with the cube tower, I mean, you dump cubes in, you don't know what's going to come out. You're also trying to remember what's already been put in the cube tower and been seeded. So you're trying to keep track of that. So that's the memory aspect. I think that would scratch that itch, though. I will admit it's a bit of a step up, a step ladder up, maybe.
So one I only learned about just recently, thanks to Mo and Dee's visit to the Gamma Expo, is Thrive. So rather than randomly picking your pieces like in the Duke or having predetermined movements like in chess, this one you customize your pieces as you play the game. Each turn, you get to place two pegs into your pieces, which determine the way those pieces move from then on in the game, allowing you to adapt your strategy with every single move you make.
Yeah, that one was neat. And technically, your two pegs don't even have to go into the same piece. You can put them on two different pieces. Yeah, we played that once now. I enjoyed it. I want a physical version of that one. I tend to do better at the physical version on this one. Plus, you got the whole grid and units on opposite sides. Next one I have, do I do the Jeff Engelstein thing or not? Citadels! Okay, for fans of other podcasts in the Dice Tower. The classic Citadels from Fantasy Flight, that's my next recommendation. And that's going for that gotcha moment, right? That the gotcha when you're planning your moves and you're moving your troops and you're getting everything ready and you've got your king out and your queen, you're about to build something and then someone drops the dang assassin. Or someone steals your last gold with the thief card and you can't build what you planned on building. This is for people whose favorite part of Stratego is flipping down that bomb or taking out a marshal with their spy or flipping over that sapper when you thought your flag was perfectly defended by that ring of bombs that was probably pretty obvious you put up at the beginning of the game.
Next, I'm going to recommend the Red Burnous, Algeria, 1857. It's historic, it's not Napoleonic, but it does have historic war theme. And in this case, it's a French invasion of Algeria. It's also cooperative, which I thought might make it a good recommendation specifically for Al and his wife, as he mentioned that aside from Stratego, his wife also enjoys cooperative games like Forbidden Island. So working together to defend your villages from the invading French armies might be the perfect next step. Or it might be a bit more like a leap, as Burnous isn't a super simple game.
And well, I seem to be the one taking on most of the unavailable games tonight. So I'll continue with that theme with Confusion, Espionage and Deception in the Cold War. Now, this is a wild one. This is sort of Risk meets Stratego meets Hanabi, where you don't know what your pieces do at the start, but your opponent does. This is actually the first in the Stronghold Games Castle line of games. And unfortunately, out of print now, but and hard to find, but perhaps interesting enough for the Stratego lover to go hunt out as you get that the opposite fog of war problem from Stratego, where you know what they do and you don't know what you do.
I gotta say, that sounds fascinating.
Yeah,
of all the games we talked about, I want to try that one. All right, my final recommendation, I'm finally going a little lighter here somewhat, is another mass market game, the updated and twisted awesome version of Risk, and that is Risk Legacy from the legacy master Rob Davio, the game that created a genre of games. Legacy games would probably not exist without Risk Legacy. Now, while the basics of moving and attacking using D6 dice, and you get more dice if you have more troops than your opponent, is the same as the base game, Legacy adds so much. And the most important is turning it into a victory point game and not a conquest game. You do not have to wipe everyone off the map. You just need to get so many victory points, which can be gotten from winning battles as well as capturing opponents' bases. I am amazed how much better just that, the first time you play Risk Legacy, how much changing the game from wipe everyone out to that makes the game better. Then, once you start playing, even after the first game, the game starts becoming asymmetric. No spoiler here. I think everyone knows that your troops start changing, but then you don't own a troop and everyone's going to draft. So don't make a troop too powerful because your opponent might grab it. And then you're going to modify the board with, they call them scars, but they're stickers you put on, and new rules are going to get added. And I like, the game is fantastic. And I don't like Risk. I hate using the term hate, but I am really not a fan of the original Risk, and I adore Risk Legacy.
Yeah, I loved when we played Risk Legacy. It was a hoot. So for my last one, can I say Zensu? Because yeah. I just feel like any recommendation list I make, I'm just going to slip Zensu in there. If what you like about Stratego are the chess-like aspects, the way you move one piece a turn while trying to eliminate your opponents, and then also the variable pieces, then you might dig Zensu. Zensu only has two different pieces with two different movement sets, and you're trying to make it to the other end of the board, not necessarily capture a particular piece, but otherwise it's kind of the same vibe. And again, it's a very approachable game with a simple to understand rulebook.
Next week, D tries to justify how Zensu is a next level game after Jaws of the Lion.
Yes.
There you go. I'm waiting for the RPG. How is Zensu a role-playing game?
All right. Well, for my final recommendation, I am going to offer you the significant next step. This is a big level up over Stratego in many ways, and that is Twilight Struggle, the number 2 war game, number 12 strategy game on all of Board Game Geek. This 2-player game will take your strategy to the next level. And I admit it's a lot heavier than the sort of games Al and his partner seem to be used to. But if they're really interested in sort of leveling up their skills and abilities, and joining, you know, headlong into the modern board gamer, hobby gamer, world, this will certainly do that for them. Rather than the next step, this might end up being the last step in a long path that only started with Stratego.
Now, again, the same caveat I gave for the Columbia Block games and Deanna mentioned for Command and Colors, Twilight Struggle is not that hard to learn. It's a card-driven area majority game. It's really not as bad as you think. You're not moving units on a map. You are playing cards to change your influence in various different regions. No one should be scared of this game. The weight on Board Game Geek, I think, is when you like putting the weight on chess high because masters play it at a level different than any other people. Twilight Struggle, once you've memorized the cards in the deck and you know exactly when to play the China card, is a different game than people sitting down to casually play it. You can play the game casually and don't be too scared of it. It is a great game. We now have the newer deluxe edition of it, and I can't wait to try it because we played the original a few times and I really want to dig into the deluxe version.
Yeah, I like that game, but you have to admit that you were intimidated by it.
Yeah,
I remember you were like, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to try and figure this one out. So it's a lot.
Like compared to Republic of Rome or again, Advanced Squad Leader or even Twilight Imperium, I think is more complicated than Twilight Struggle. Yeah, when I joined Board Game Geek, Twilight Struggle was the number one game in the world, and I think it was there for 5 years. And it really hasn't dropped that much for a game that's that old. It's been around since 2005. All right, I'm going to throw in one honorable mention. And the reason is, as I mentioned before, we do research before we do this. And generally what I do is I sit down and I make my list. And then I go, do I forget anything? And that research involves walking around my own game room and looking around to see if I forgot anything, but also Googling to see if other people have covered this particular topic. And while some people have, there weren't as many articles as I expected. So yay for filling a niche. Other than that, though, I noticed on almost every single list of next step games from Stratego, people listed Summoner Wars. This was on Reddit. This was in Board Game Geek threads. It was on Geeklist. It was on Blocks. This is strongly recommended by others. Now, I played this game. I tried it once years ago. Dice Tower Tom really loved this game and was proselytizing it, like going on about it. And I tried a copy of it. And I just didn't love it. Now, I will admit I played it on an app, so maybe that was my problem. But I also played like the original version 1.0 version when Plaid Hat first put it out. And there have been, I think, 3 editions. And I keep hearing every new edition's better. So maybe I need to sit down and try this game again. Now, this is 2 players. They're sitting across each other. There's a grid. The goal is to take out a specific unit. I think it's your general. I don't quite remember. The neat part in this is that it's asymmetric. There are many different army decks out there. So I would take like my elf deck. Sean would take his dwarf deck and we could battle each other. I think there's some aspects of Fog of War with cards being placed face down. If not from that, there's at least what's in your hand. You never know what your opponent has in their hand and what they're going to bring to the table next. So asymmetric, different decks, non-collectible. That's important. You just buy the deck you want to play. I'm going to recommend this one. because everyone else is recommending this one, and I'm going to task myself with actually giving it another shot sometime.
All right. Well, now that we've covered our next step from Stratego game recommendations from the team, let's see what the lobby, our chat room, has to add. And the first one I notice, Eggman Jr. mentioned Battle Lore, which is sadly long out of print. Followed by
now Battle Lore, there are different editions of, and I've got to say, I love the first edition. The first edition of Battle Lore actually is historic. They used orcs and goblins and dwarves, but you're actually playing through the War of the Roses, mm-hmm. and the scenarios are actual recreations of battles. Then Fantasy Flight put out the second edition. Now, I think the second edition's more fun. The second edition is all fantasy troops. There's no tie to reality. And how you set up your troops is determined on a random deck, not some set scenario. And it's neat and it's fun. And it's more of a wild, crazy game. But if you want the next step to Stratego, if you can find that first edition of Battle Lore, that's what I recommend. And if you can find it, it tends to be cheap. And there's lots of extra armies out there. And there's goblin wolf riders and everything. But the neat part is you're playing actual historic battles.
All right, next up, again from Eggman, we have Memoir 44.
Yep,
more actual historic battles.
followed by Undaunted. And this is one I actually saw other people mentioning in some of my research as well. The Undaunted, or even the Versus games.
I thought about Undaunted as an honorable mention, but I haven't played it. So. Yeah,
I've heard really good things about Undaunted. It's one I actually want to try. There's a bunch of different versions. People are saying like that is the light war game now. Like if you're going to get into light, like waros, as they call them, when it's a mashup of war game and Euro war based board games, that Undaunted is the place to go, the place to start. I've heard so many good things about that one.
Hold on. Waros? I've never heard that waros. Term before.
Where you I'm take amused a Euro and a waro. Red Burnous right. is very much a waro.
Excellent.
Alrighty then. And then Battle Line, again by Eggman Jr.
Oh, that's going real class. That's another Nizia. That's where your armies are just represented by cards and you're playing area control in a whole, like a bunch of different spots, right? So you have a strip, right? And you play your cards on your side, your opponent plays on the other, and you're going back and forth. I just thought of one, Sean, you and I played at Origins that would have been a good recommendation we missed, which was Air, Land, and Sea. With that neat area control game. I think we played the creature version, but...
Mm-hmm. It was with me, you played it.
It was with the?
No, I played it too. I definitely played it with
maybe you showed it to Sean, too. Maybe we both did it.
Possibly. Maybe we both did it, yeah.
I gotta say, when Eggman Jr. said Battle Line in the chat, I was like, oh, that's a good one. I hadn't thought of that one.
Air, Land, and Sea is a better version of Battle Line. I'm sorry for fans of the original. I know Battle Line's classic and people love it. I had more fun with Air, Land, and Sea.
Roger is adding a vote for War Chest. And Eggman Jr. mentions the Steam version is a great way to learn Twilight Struggle. And I actually I have the Steam version. But again, it's one of those daunting games. I've never actually even, never even loaded it up.
It really isn't that bad. Like honestly, it belongs on. I think we've done a list, and I don't remember if we put it on it, of surprisingly easy games compared to their reputation and how bad they look. Now, part of it is GMT writes war games, and war gamers tend to like to write rule books like technical manuals for some reason that makes them extremely difficult to learn. Whereas, like, if I sit you down and we start playing, like, we could be playing Twilight Struggle, in like 10 minutes because it's really not that hard.
I mean, you don't have to take 10 minutes to get me playing Twilight Imperium. I'm there.
If you wanted to play Twilight Imperium, it's going to take more than 10 minutes to set up the board.
Well, yes. I meant Twilight Struggle. There's also lighter versions of Twilight Struggle that have come out. I can't remember the names of them. I know Making of the President is one, which shows that it's just an area control game. But there's a more recent one that came out, and it's Twilight Struggles. I'm drawing a blank, but there is a new lighter version.
All right, and then
Twilight, any of that. Watergate is a tug of war game, back and forth, and
which deduction. I kind of enjoyed, but Mo didn't.
Actually, the card play in that, I guess, is slightly similar to Twilight Struggle.
Roger was asking about Shogun. So basically, Shogun came out first, and then Wallenstein was
other way around.
It was the other way around.
Wallenstein's the first game.
Is Wallenstein the one that we had to get like the translations of to be able to play it? Oh, yep. And it went, Well, then I got it backwards in my head. Sorry.
Wallenstein, I actually played the original version.
Yeah. Okay. I know we have both kicking around. That's
13 days, I think, is the one I was trying to think of. 13 days, the Cuban Missile Crisis. And the other one, the actual name was Twilight Squabble. So 13 days is rated better. So
okay.
Twilight Squabble.
They're definitely
so I gotta say, Twilight on Squabble,
the popularity of the other name.
Scratch it. Don't even bother with Twilight Squabble. It's rated. It's in the top 20,000 games of all time.
All right, then.
It is rated a 5.6. That is really low for
wow. When you said Risk Legacy earlier was the first Legacy game, I wanted to stop and Google it. I'm like, the first one I remember was when Time Stories came out, going, it's a disposable game. And you change things.
Time Stories is older.
And I actually thought Time Stories came out first before Risk Legacy.
There's nothing you do in Time. Time Stories came out 10 years after.
10 years after Risk Legacy? Because to me, it was a disposable game. And that was the first time that they were like, you can only play it once. And you're going to like
4 years after Risk Legacy. And I don't know. It's not disposable. It's just you can only play it once.
Yeah.
You don't rip anything up. You don't.
I remember being in the car and listening to a podcast about it and thinking that's the stupidest idea I've ever heard. And now I dig that style of game. But
and then I think the last mention we've got there from the chat room is a space version of Undaunted is coming out soon.
See, that's cool. That interests me way more than Modern Warfare. I got to say that is one of the reasons I haven't gotten into Undaunted is I don't have, I am not a war gamer. I am not a historic war gamer. I'm more likely to play like Napoleonic's about as modern as I want to get. I prefer Warhammer, Battle Lore. there's a Command and Colors version of A Song of Fire and Ice. I think that might also be a Battle Lore version. I'm more into that than I am playing historic games. Ancients is fine. I don't know why. I don't know. Feels too close to home when you get into modern games. I'm not sure. So that's it for our list of games we think Stratego fans will enjoy. Great next step games from Stratego. I hope this helps you find the perfect game for your wife, Al.
So how did we do? Did we miss a game do you think would be perfect for Al's wife? Let us know in the comments.
Or better yet, jump on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com and start up a conversation there.